I'd like to call the meeting to order, August 24, 2015 work session. Roll call. Councilmember Clayton?
Here.
Councilmember Kendall? Councilmember Warner?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Here.
Mayor Moore?
Here.
At this time, would everybody please rise for a sign of prayer or a moment of reflection? Flag salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coastal Star Ledger on January 2, 2015, and posted on the bulletin board on the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk.
All right, all matters brought up for follow-up, the work session meeting of July 20, 2015, were reported out on the regular meeting of July 22, 2015. All right, there were no outstanding issues for follow-up from the regular meeting of July 22, 2015. So we'll move right into our regular agenda. All right, special events and wedding applications. Tom Dooley.
Bunch of special events applications here. The first one is Walk in Her Shoes, which is a walk that's being organized to support and in memory of Tamara Seidel. Take place on August 29th in Liberty Library State Park from 10 to 12. They will congregate in the park and then march down First Avenue to Main Street and back to the park.
Which park, Tom?
Library.
So is that information that came later? Because in the application, is this the application that was like, I'd like to do this at some time,
somewhere,
just to prove it?
Yes.
Okay.
And what happened is they originally wanted to come into Sunset Park. That's why they put whatever area is available. There's another event in Sunset Park that Saturday. Then they wanted to move to Bradley Park. We really didn't want to have a march down to the beach. So we eventually asked them if they'd be available to move to Library Park. And that's what they decided to do.
Okay.
Tom, is this a fundraiser or just...
No, it's not a fundraiser.
Okay.
It's a tribute. Any questions on this? Okay. And we presented this one early to you ahead of time because they needed to get out the word out ahead of time.
Oh, this is the event that already took place?
No. It takes place this Saturday. No. But they needed to promote it.
But we already talked about it.
The next one is the Summer Carnival, which actually did take place this past weekend. And I hope everything's okay with that one.
Yes.
Yep. Okay. We did review that, just so the public knows, we did review it prior. The next application is the Atlantic City Free Giveaway. This is an application submitted by the applicant that was doing the car thing down at the casino building. They actually wanted to move it to Fifth Avenue, on the boardwalk to Fifth Avenue, and change what they were doing. They wanted to have Atlantic City Free Giveaways. This, as you read probably at the bottom of this, in the fee section there, the Special Events Committee was really not happy with the idea of moving something down to Fifth Avenue, which is much crowder than the casino. If you remember when this applicant first applied, they applied and wanted to be at Fifth Avenue. We moved them down to the casino. So if you do decide to approve this, the change of what they're giving away, it is our preference that it stay down by the casino and not at Fifth Avenue.
And this is the thing I threw a fit about last time, where...
And this is the thing we're going to vote no about on the recommendation of the Special Events Committee, which is highlighted in the back.
Well, I was going to say I'm a no, but...
Okay, thank you.
We're four no's.
The next one is Coast to Coast for Cancer. This is a, it's a, an event that is a bike ride, it's a fundraiser for cancer that's actually finishing in Asbury Park. They're coming from the West Coast. So they're asking to rent Bradley Park on September 29th from 3 p.m. to 9 p.m. in celebration of the bike riders that are coming back as part of this.
Okay.
The next application is the Greek Orthodox Holy Cross Day Celebration. This is an event that has taken place as long as I've been here, to take place September 27th from 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. They rent Bradley Park and then do the annual Blessings of the Water. Any questions on that one? Okay. And the next two were applications that came in actually late, but were included in your packet. The Special Events Committee has met with both these. The first one is the Bond Street Bar. They are requesting to put a mobile stage, which is actually a van that comes out and the stage flips out of that, on September 4th from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. in front of the Bond Street Bar. They wanted to take a parking place, as I described in my memo, and it was the recommendation of the Special Events Committee that they close the street, which they've agreed to do. As I mentioned to you today, if hopefully you read that email, that they wanted to actually have a second date on that, October 10th. And I indicated to the applicant that I would ask the council on that, but we would need, as a Special Events Committee, we would need to review it again, especially since they've, in case anything happened on this first event and stuff like that. So we'd like you to approve both dates, but know that we will bring them back in front of the Special Events Committee to review the second date.
So when's the first date?
September 4th.
Now, what did we decide on that?
We asked them, we gave them a choice of either putting it in a parking lot next to Bond Street Bar or actually...
And what'd they say to that?
Closing. Because there's residential parking in that, that wasn't available to them.
It's a three-hour event. It's only 3 hours during the day. That's going to disrupt their residential parking. I mean, I would much prefer this to be in their parking lot and closing down a city street on September 4th, which is what, a Friday?
Friday, right.
Labor Day Friday?
But there's residents that live in the building above Taka, the old Taka site, that actually park their cars there.
And they're just closing the street by...
From Madison to Cookman. Yep.
I think the committee recommended it.
We had questions about it. No, we didn't recommend it. We asked them to have it in their own lot, so we don't have to close down the street.
But again, it's really not their lot.
Okay. It's a two-hour event. It's from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. And again, what they asked to do is not close down the block.
And yeah, they just wanted to rent up parking space.
Takes all the sidewalk, and nobody would be able to walk up and down the sidewalk. If this is a compromise, okay. But the second event is not a whole, pull the second event altogether. The October 1 talk goes back to special events.
Okay.
And just let's okay one at a time.
Yep, that's fine. Any other questions on that? And I should say there'll be no alcohol outside the bar, so they can't bring alcohol out into the street. Very important. The next one is an application called Indian Summer, presented from Madison Marquette. This would be an event that would take place September 26th from 11 a.m. to 10 p.m. in the North Beach area, right outside of Anchor's Bend. You all got a diagram, I hope, that was in your packet there to show about that. And the request from this, which is a little bit different, is that they are requesting to have camping, overnight camping, on the Sunset Avenue, Sixth Avenue Beach. 40 camping sites, limited to 40 tents. And they would camp on the beach overnight and would be off the beach by 10 a.m. the following morning. We talked about a number of issues with this. One was security. It was our recommendation that we have one police officer on site at all times, and also their own security, plus two lifeguards during the daytime, just in case people end up going into the ocean. There would be, the security would make sure that no one went into the ocean after the lifeguards leave.
Does anybody have any questions?
Just why do they want to camp out on the beach?
Go ahead.
I would say it's become the end thing to do. Seaside Heights had two of these this year. They've been very successful. And
why wouldn't you want to sleep on the beach?
What?
I said, why wouldn't you want to sleep on the beach?
I wouldn't. That's me.
And it's starting off small, and maybe one day it will get bigger and bigger. But Madison Market made a good proposal as far as like the pluses and the minuses, and the committee thought there were very few minuses whatsoever. And we asked all the questions as far as like what Seaside Heights demanded, as far as like bathroom facilities, shower facilities, every facility. There's no propane, there's no cooking in these tents whatsoever. Their coolers will be checked. They cannot take liquor onto the beach. It's a family-friendly event. Take in the off-season, which we're trying to get more people into Asbury Park.
Okay, so something that families will be doing. It's not just for singles that are going to be camping out on.
I can't guarantee who's
packing up their kids to go sleep.
The one they did in
my parents used to do it to me.
All right.
And in Seaside, it was like very family friendly.
Okay.
Right, so it was modeled after that. That was like a very family friendly event. There was not one problem, which is maybe rare for Seaside. But there was none.
I didn't have any problem. The only thing I worried about one officer, that was my only concern, if the committee feels...
But they'll have their own security staff there.
Two.
They'll have three of their own.
Three of their own.
Hang on just a minute.
I thought it said
here?
Two.
Chris?
Two to three. I said two to three in the meeting and with one police officer. And Lieutenant Thompson was in there and said that was sufficient.
So if the committee thinks one is fine, then that's fine. I probably would have gone for two the first year, but mm-hmm. I'm not on the committee.
That decision, as far as the committee.
I assume the police said we only need to...
Correct. The committee listens to police as far as police issues. The committee listens to fire as far as fire issues. And then any other issues we all get involved in. But be it they are public safety knowledgeable people, we take their guidance.
So if it's 40 tents, and is there a limit on the tents or the people?
There's a limit to the size of the tents, which I believe is 12 by 12. So you're probably talking maximum four people in a tent, I would think. But if you had some kids, I guess you could get more people in there.
Okay, listen, if police said one officer, that's fine.
One other question. Is there a rain date?
Good question. No, there's not.
Okay. No, but they have made arrangements that if there's lightning or something like that they would move people in to Convention Hall. So they have a plan that if a storm comes or something like that happens.
Okay.
Very well thought out application.
Okay.
And if I could just interject, you may have seen in the packages that Tom included a copy of our current ordinance, which technically prohibits sleeping on the beach and camping overnight in tents, so you would need to temporarily suspend that ordinance. So I'm going to add some language into the special events resolution that you'll be considering for Wednesday, such that if you are going to approve this event, that you'll temporarily suspend that ordinance relating to this organized event at that specific location on that specific date.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. The next one is a wedding that'll take place same day, September 4th. I don't know if they're going to camp after they get married, but maybe. And that'll take place on the First Avenue Beach. Any questions? And the last item is a letter from the Asbury Park Fishing Club.
Yeah, but I meant to talk to you today. I talked to Tony. I think that should be pulled. I think it's a good letter of reference for us. But that should go back to the Special Events Committee because I honestly, and I'm going to have to confuse myself, obviously, because I'm a member of the Asbury Park Fishing Club, but they do not list costs, and I would also like want to see a list of what they donated every year to charities, which I know is unbelievably outstanding.
Yep.
So, but I think this should, there's no hurry. This is not to March. So send it back to the special events before we discuss it.
Yeah, there isn't any real hurry, but they mentally like to lock that date in ahead of time.
Well, the date's locked in. It's just a question if we give them what they want, and we have to figure out what they want.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep, no problem.
Thank you.
Yep. Thank you.
Right, under presentation, let's see. I want to deviate from the agenda quickly, and I want to move down to item number 2. All right, items presented by Christine Ballard, P&amp;F Associates. All right, boardwalk lighting project and the outfall diffuser repairs at the wastewater treatment plant.
Good evening.
Good evening.
As many of you may know, the bids were received for the boardwalk lighting project.
Can everybody hear?
No.
Okay.
Talk closer into the, is that better? Okay. The bids were received for the boardwalk lighting project. As many of you may know, we have a grant in the amount of roughly $925,000. The bids for the boardwalk lighting project do exceed the grant that the city has available. I have had a discussion with iStar. iStar is willing to pay the difference in cost for the project so it can move forward at virtually no cost to the city. However, they have not provided the funding yet. So what I'd like to do is table this resolution for Wednesday, put it on a following meeting, probably, I guess, your first meeting in September, and then you can vote on it. This way, the CFO has funds in the account available, and he can certify that funds are there. Okay?
I just had a real quick question on that. When we vote on that, are we going to be voting on the, because a while ago we saw a model of light. Are we going to be voting on just awarding the contract? Because I had questions about the actual type of light that was going to be going
okay.
on the boardwalk.
The model has already been selected, and that was included in the bid documents that went out to bid. I can certainly get you that information, what it looks like, color rendering.
So
that
to me, I don't understand, because we had that in our packet. It was pulled, so I didn't have any of my questions, and now it's already out to bid. I went through that process.
Well, the only thing I'll say is, and this was just through a separate meeting with Brian about workforce development, not at all related to the boardwalk, was the main business on the boardwalk that had the concerns. I believe he has spoken to and resolved those concerns. So if you have your own concerns about it, then it's okay. A different issue. But it's my understanding, and we should double check that before Wednesday, that the concerns of the couple of businesses, or certainly one business on the boardwalk, have been resolved.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I had other concerns. I mean, they looked like they were like a little, well, I guess it's too late.
Well, the project has, believe it or not, been around since Sandy.
Right.
It's been around for quite some time. It was just a matter of kind of pushing it forward and getting it out to bid. So the bid documents were completed actually in advance of me coming here.
Right.
It was just a matter of advertising the bids and getting the prices in order. But I can get you that information. There's they are LED lights.
Right, that was one of the concerns, was the warmth of them, that they're not like this white blue light along the whole boardwalk,
right,
as well as the direction. We don't want to, my thought was not to have them shine up, that they're directionally
right
down.
I believe they are Night Star light compliant.
Yeah.
And they are not quite as blue. I can see if I told you on the spectrum what it was by number, that probably wouldn't mean anything, right?
Right. Yeah, no, the concern is just when you light up the whole boardwalk and it's like a white blue,
right,
it's a little cold, it's not
right
real warm, and it has a, it has
right
kind of
one of the advantages of these lights is they are dimmable.
Okay.
So that's good for multiple reasons. Good for energy conservation purposes. So during normal hours, it will be brighter when people are around. And then when the traffic dies down, these lights do dim, and it helps conserve a lot of energy that way. So it keeps it safe, so it's still lit, but it's not bright lit all the time.
All right. And then my other question, then, Tony, this is maybe to you, I'm not sure if it's to, but, and it deals with ISTAR, which is great that they're paying for it, so it's very nice. We're very appreciative. And I was just wondering, I know like years back when the city was trying to document infrastructure improvements that had been made, somebody got up to the mic and had asked for like, where did the $40 million go that Larry Fishman spent on infrastructure? And I'm just wondering, now that we've kind of reset and we have our infrastructure going into the ground, and some of it is being upfront paid for by ISTAR, some of it is being paid for by the special assessments as they go forward with each. Do we have a record of the infrastructure that's being put in, like hard and soft infrastructure, and then what has been paid for by ISTAR, and then what the special assessment has paid to this point for different pieces? So just so like say in 5 years, someone says, which I think we should have, where's the, you know, the listing of who's paid for what? How much has come from special assessment versus how much has come from ISTAR? So I was just wondering if we could track that down.
Ricky, I don't know if Ricky has comment on that, but I'll reach out to him to talk about it tomorrow. And I'll reach out to Brian as well.
Okay, great.
Are there any further questions on the boardwalk lighting project?
Just one question. What about the alternates?
The alternates are not going to be awarded at this time. There were a couple, I don't want to say concerns because they really weren't concerns. ISTAR just decided they did not want to move forward with the alternates, therefore they weren't going to fund the alternates. The second item that I have on is regarding the outfall diffuser repairs at the wastewater treatment plant. What I'm asking for at this time is authorization to begin preparing plans and specifications to do repairs at this outfall pipe. I don't know, most of you probably know there is a wastewater treatment plant at the beachfront. Once the wastewater is treated, it is discharged into the ocean. Well, I drew a little sketch here. This is what it looks like. There's a 24-inch pipe, which is actually buried in the sand, and then there were 43 diffusers where the water comes up and out at a T. This goes along the entire length of the pipe. The diffusers, we had a dive inspection, and the diffusers, only 11 of the 43 are still operational. So we are requesting authorization to put together plans and specifications to have them repaired. This project, I have spoken with the CFO, no additional bonding is necessary. There's funds available for this project.
Okay. Any questions?
One thing I would like to add is the dive inspection. We were only able to see the diffusers because they come up through the sand. There is potential that while we're doing the repairs, we could find damages to the pipe itself, which is buried in the sand. After speaking with the plant superintendent, he feels fairly confident that there aren't any damages with regard to the pipe, but I did just want to make you aware of that.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I have no questions, but a couple comments. This is a lot of money, but this is money that has to be spent. Again, we have 26 diffusers, and we're down to how many?
Well, there's 46, and we're at 11.
46, and we're down to what?
11.
11. And if we lost, and these are rhetorical questions, because Christine and I are there, just so the public knows, and the rest of the council, if they don't know, if we lost a couple more, our option would be tanker trucks. And we're pumping 2 million gallons a day. There ain't enough tanker trucks in America. And there's not enough money in New Jersey to pay for this.
Right.
And part of the problem here is, and anything I say wrong, please correct me, we cannot blame this on Sandy, because the city did the same type of survey in 2012 before Sandy and saw the same thing and took no action on it, budgeted no money for it, and left us in this predicament. So this is something that was known since 2012. We've been on borrowed time and cannot go any further.
Correct.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, moving back to item number one under presentation. All right, we have Michelle Alonzo, our city planner, all right, to talk about potential amendments to the city land development regulations.
Good evening. Good evening, council members. This is a referring resolution to the planning board.
You're going to speak up. It may be off.
No, I think it's on. It's just low, and I have a soft voice. So, good evening, council members. This is a referring resolution to the planning board to examine mostly the procedural sections of the land development ordinance, as well as the regulations for fences. One that we want to examine is raising the escrow fees for applications that do not involve a site plan. We've been comparing our fees with some of the Monmouth County municipalities, and for applications for variances without site plan, appeals, subdivisions, our escrow initial deposit is on the low side. We've also been looking at how much it caught our professionals bill towards that escrow, and almost every application needs a replenishment. We're also looking to amend the escrow ordinance to include two professionals that can draw down from the escrow, the city engineer and the city attorney. Currently, they are not in the list of professionals who are part of the site plan or subdivision variance process, and thus cannot draw down on escrows from developers. Part of application procedures, one of the things that upon my coming here, I discovered that the submittal requirements for all types of applications probably can be revisited, that there needs to be some clarifications on what should be included in a site plan application, and also some of the types of applications have very subjective submission requirements. So that's something else that we will look at and we would like to update. And finally, I initially was going to keep this amendment as my first amendment as a procedure amendment, but also one of the items among a few in our land development ordinance that seems to need some urgent updating is fences, particularly the types of fences that are currently permitted in front yards, but also to clean up that section as it pertains to all fences for all sides and retaining walls. Does anyone have any questions?
So the only thing I'll say regarding fences, and I think most people know I don't love fences and vote no on projects because of fences at times, is that you look at when you're cleaning it up, can you, are people grandfathered in if they currently have the fence? Which is fine. I actually think that is a more reasonable response than requiring all these people to remove their fence. So when you're looking at it, I just want, you know, I don't know legally that you can do it, but if there's a grandfather clause, I would just like to see with it and without it or something like that.
Right. In New Jersey, we're not permitted to amortize. So, yes, anyone who has a fence and it's documented as a legal fence up until the date the ordinance has changed can keep that fence until they take it down or it falls down.
Okay. Anything else from Michelle?
No, so thank you for updating the fees after 20 years of being neglected.
Your third item on your work session agenda presentations is the presentation by our city auditor, David Kaplan. All right, to talk about the ordinance for 2014.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
So we have completed the audit for fiscal year end 12/31/14 for the city. Happy to report that the independent auditor's report is dated August 20th, 2015, and that's an unmodified opinion from us on the regulatory basis of accounting that's prescribed by the Division of Local Government Services. So when an auditor says that you received an unmodified opinion, that's really his highest form of assurance that the financial statements are prepared in conformity with the regulatory basis of accounting that the state has prescribed. So that's really what you're looking for, and I'm happy to report that's what we were able to issue. There's also two other opinions that we give, both on internal control and compliance. Those reports are modified or qualified with respect to grants, and mainly the CDBG program, which I'll get into in a few minutes. Couple snapshots. Remember that this audit is a snapshot in time at 12/31/14. Some financial highlights. As of that date, the city had $19.7 million in cash and cash equivalents, had zero tax anticipation notes, although they were renewed in 15, had net debt of about $17.2 million, short-term notes of about $6 million, special emergency notes of $300,000 from Sandy, had a tax levy of about $25.6 million and collected 99.78% of that tax levy, mainly due to the accelerated tax sale that the city has each year. But still, 99.78 is high. With respect to where you stood in financial position, fund balance in the current fund was the highest that it ever has been in the city's history. At 12/31/14, you ended with $3.412 million in current fund balance. So really good news there. On the flip side, however, the sewer utility ended with 12/31/14 fund balance of $367, the lowest that the sewer utility has ever had in the city's history. So we have quite extremes going on there. With respect to the beach utility, ended with $232,665, up about $103,000 from the prior year, so the beach had a good year. And parking continues to do well, had a fund balance of $1,142,460, which is up about $80,000 from the prior year. So those are some snapshots of, you know, cash position, debt position, fund balance position. So all in all, except for the sewer utility, the city's in great shape, and I'm sure the CFO has some plans to get the sewer utility's fund balance back where it belongs. With respect to audit recommendations, we do make audit recommendations this year. They can be found on the very last page of the report. And I'm going to go over the seven audit recommendations that we made, because you're going to have to do a corrective action plan that addresses each one, so that these things don't happen again. Five of them are related to the CDBG program. I'll go over those last. And the other two, I'm gonna go over now. One of those is competitive bids you solicited whenever necessary. There were a couple items that you didn't go out to bid for. SpectraServe comes to mind, where you had not bid that last year. You didn't bid it again this year. You have subsequently bid it, so that's straightened out now to the benefit of the city. But during 2014, bids were not solicited for that service and one other, which I believe was garbage-related. The other recommendation we made.
Can I wait, Dave, before you go to the next one, just because we can knock out my question now.
Sure.
I don't understand. I don't think these are paged, but it's your general comments, December 31st, 2014.
Uh-huh.
When it talks about, because I noticed that we're getting in trouble for these going above the cap. What I assume is going above the cap.
Okay.
So why does it say it's 36? If we have a qualified purchasing agent, and then it's 25, and the city state, I don't understand the difference between the 36 and the 25.
Okay.
Because that was what we voted on. If we could have gone up to 36, but it was the recommendation of the CMFO just to go to 25, and we voted on that.
Why wouldn't you always go higher in case things?
The lower your bid threshold, the more conservative you are, because you're requiring bids at a lower level. If you went to 36, you wouldn't have to bid anything up to here. You're conservative and staying at 25, so you have to bid more everything at 25. It's a
so
higher threshold.
So what's the purpose of staying low?
So
it's more because if we had gone to 36, then we wouldn't be in this trouble. Because
no, even yeah, for these items, items, you would have been over anyway.
Okay.
More of an oversight.
So this keeps more of an oversight on what we're requiring going out to bid for.
Right.
Now and it's better to keep a lower number than a higher number.
It is.
Okay.
That 36 went to 40, by the way, effective 1/1/15, I believe.
Okay.
7/1.
Yes. I have no idea of that. So, done.
Okay, so that's recommendation number 6, and I think you're in good shape on that one already. With respect to number 7, all interfunds will be liquidated prior to year end. Interfunds are basically borrowings between various funds that you have in the city. So you have your current fund, which is your main operating fund. You have your animal control, your trust other, general capital, the parking fund, the beach fund, the sewer fund, grant fund. All those funds have some borrowing between them. That's fine during the year, but when the year end comes, all those funds, all those borrowings should be liquidated. And that's our audit recommendation number 14-7.
When you say that, can you explain that? So, like,
yeah, let's say here's a good example. So, say there's a check comes in for something, and it should have went to the current fund. You should say $100,000 check comes in, should have been deposited in the current fund, but it was deposited in the wrong fund because whatever, it was a mistake. And I'm just giving you this example. Sometime during the year, they should have moved that money from where it was errantly deposited to the proper place where it belonged, so that that wouldn't create it. The interfund would be gone. There's no borrowing between the funds. Okay, so that repayment didn't occur in your case specifically, and that's just one example of how the interfunds. Some of the interfunds are not. They're going to happen. Because of the way New Jersey's governmental accounting is set up, like relationship between the current fund and the grant fund, those interfunds are understandable and they're going to be there. Those aren't really the ones we're focusing on, but there are others that will be to your benefit to liquidate as soon as possible. With respect to CDBG, our firm was required to do what's called a single audit. So anytime a municipal governmental entity expends over $500,000 in federal or $500,000 in state monies, that triggers a single audit. You had a single audit required for federal programs only. The two programs that we tested were FEMA and CDBG. Those were our single audit focus. FEMA turned out to be perfect. Tracy inherited quite a mess and strained it out. So I'm happy to report that all the tests we did, the controls, compliance testing for FEMA worked out well, and we have no audit recommendations with respect to FEMA. However, with respect to CDBG, we found instances of non-compliance regarding allowable costs. And if you have any specific questions about each one of these, just feel free. But we have an order recommendation that whatever programs you're going to fund with the CDBG program have to be stated in the action plan or the CAPR, which is a subsequent amendment to the action plan. You can't do projects that you haven't told CDBG you're going to do, basically. And you did, and that's a violation.
Wait, say that again, Dave?
You can't fund programs out of your CDBG grant money that you don't have pre-approval for.
Pre-approval by who?
CDBG.
So I'm only going to, as somebody who started on the CDBG committee in the last year and okay. is attempting to help reform that process, right? That's my role for 2015 and 2016. I will tell you without a doubt, we have called HUD and said, these are programs we want to fund. And they say, we can't tell you whether that is okay or not. You fund what you want to fund, and if we audit you and have a problem with it, we'll let you know. But I can tell you there were at least two programs where we said, listen, here's something we think is a real asset to the community. We want to fund it. We think it meets the requirements, but we want to double check with you. And they have absolutely said in an email, we will not approve you for this or not approve you. We won't tell you anything. So I'm just telling you the practical experience in dealing with the federal government with this grant.
Okay.
It's enough to drive a person to drink.
It is. There's a myriad of regulations and compliance issues that are required. And that certainly isn't our understanding that any program that you fund has to have pre-approval.
You weren't the meeting.
I was there.
And is it me or did they say we're not going to tell you? We're going to catch you if you've done something wrong, but we're absolutely not going to assist you in this process. Tony was there. I am not even mildly exaggerating their response to us. So just an FYI on CDBG. So I don't know what you want us to do about that. Maybe if we give them the audit report and say they have to pre-approve, because we're starting the process for 2015 right now.
Yeah, they're going to get a copy of the report, that's for sure. They're going to get a copy of the report, so.
Okay.
Get a copy of the report to Pallone also.
Next one is cash management. You're on a reimbursement basis, but you do submit requisitions, and you're paid for each one of the requisitions that you submit for reimbursement. Those reimbursement requisitions were not detailed and not supported properly, so we really couldn't tell what you were being reimbursed for. So that's a cash management issue. There's a Davis-Bacon Act issue where you have to get certified payrolls under certain circumstances. If you're doing certain projects with contractors, they have to supply their certified payrolls to you so you can determine they're paying prevailing wage.
Okay. I think that we did.
That didn't happen.
Well, not when I've been on it, though, right? This is 2014.
This is 2014.
Okay.
Next is subrecipient monitoring. When you give a grant out, you evaluate what the person is asking for. You think if the program is worthy. You look at the goals and objectives that the person is saying we're going to do. That's fine. But once the program's over, you need to go back and monitor whether the goals and objectives of the program that they said they were going to do were met and document that. That didn't happen.
Can we require, we're going to do that, again, this is just since I've been on the committee, we're also requiring a final report, which to measure the goals and objectives of the, okay.
That'll work.
Most of what Dave is saying he found in fall in 2014, we're on top of already in 2015.
Okay, number five. Has to do with environmental reviews. When you have contractors performing certain work in the city, they may or may not require an environmental review prior to them commencing the work. If you determine that they are exempt from an environmental review, you need to document why you have felt that they are exempt from the environmental review. You can't just say they're exempt, you have to actually document what section exempts them. So that's our recommendation there, and I think that's it. So if you have any questions about the audit or our findings, feel free to ask me now.
I had a question in Exhibit A, I think 2 of 2. There was master plan update funds in 2013. 2014, there were funds there. In 2015, or 2013, yeah, 2014, there was none.
Right.
I was just wondering, and I don't know if this is a question to you or for Ricky, but...
Yeah, well, it's explained on Exhibit 24A.
It
is. If you go to 24A, I apologize if you'll page number, so it's a little difficult to follow. But I'm sure those funds were expended during 2014.
So, Dave, and I went through this audit.
Sure. Expended on...
For master plan stuff.
Yeah. Yes.
These recommend, and for, I don't know why, but it's a thick, thick document. That's probably why. Where are these recommendations for CDBG? Just so I email them out to the committee, Tony will go over them with Cassandra, and we ensure that we run it at least better than we ran it last year.
I did sit with Cassandra and went over each one and informed her before we finalized the report. So
can you email them to me too, just so I have them?
Yeah, they're in the schedule of findings and question costs section of the report, which is towards the back in the grant section.
Before or after general comments?
Before. Anyone else?
Got them.
Yeah.
I don't think so. Well, no, I don't think so.
One second.
No. There's all those questions.
Well, Yvonne's looking for hers.
Yeah.
So the parking out of the surplus, $1 million was paid out to the general fund. Is that correct? Where I saw that? It says $1 million. And again,
let me get with you.
Yes. Right, that was taken out of the parking utility to put to the general fund. No, that was it.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. Just two questions on Exhibit D, sheet of 2 of 2.
Okay.
It talks about bonds and notes that were authorized but not issued for December of 2014 and 2013,
okay.
Item 22B.
All right.
So that's monies that we authorized, but we didn't do anything with it?
You authorized the debt, but you didn't issue the debt. That's what that means.
So it was withdrawn?
No, it just means that if you pass a bond ordinance and you authorize debt to be issued as part of the project, it just means that the debt that you authorized had not been issued yet. That's all it means. The project can still go on, but the debt just didn't get authorized.
Okay. And the last one is, I can't give you a page number.
Okay.
But it's City of Asbury Park notes to basic financial statements.
Okay.
It says that in December 2013, the financial statement reflected a de-obligation debt?
Yes. So the NJEIT, New Jersey Environmental Infrastructure Trust, is your preferred borrower or your preferred issuer for debt in the sewer utility. That's who you've gone through. You have some other type of debt, but mainly it's NJEIT debt, mainly because they have very low cost of issuance and they have very good interest rates, sometimes half of market interest rate or even less. So NJEIT was clearly the way for you to go. Periodically, NJEIT will measure your program and say, okay, let's say you said you were going to borrow $1 million and your project was going to be $1 million, but hey, your project came in at $800,000. That $200,000, you're not going to spend, and you don't have to pay us back either. That's what a de-obligation is. So it's a reduction of the program.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And maybe this is not, I shouldn't ask you this one, but I just wanted to know. Exhibit A, sheet 1 of 2.
Okay.
In 2013, it says we have excess of $13 million in cash and cash equivalents.
Yes.
And then in 2014, we've got $5 million, 5.6.
Yes.
Do you know what happened between 2013 and 2014?
Yes. You paid back a $9 million tax anticipation note in 2014, and that accounts for most of the reduction. That's the major driver for that reduction.
Okay.
No more tax anticipation notes at the end of 14. You did renew it in 15, but at 12/31/14, you had paid it off.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Exhibit A1, sheet 1 of 2.
Okay.
Receipt from current taxes, 2013, $24,400,000, 2014, $25,600,000. That's good, right?
Yeah, you collected another $1,150,000 in taxes. Okay. Yeah, maybe post a levy one.
Okay. Notes to basic financial statements, long-term debt, and borrowing power under NJS 40A-2-6 is amended.
Yep.
So the city right now is valued at $1.2 billion. We can legally borrow up to 3.5%, which is $44 million, and we're only at $17 million, so we're in good shape there.
You have 27.5 remaining borrowing power.
Not that we want to borrow anymore, but...
Not that you want to, but you could if you had to.
Right.
As long as the state approves it, because you're still
right
in their program.
Okay. Section 2C, sheet 2 of 2. City of Asbury Park General Capital Fund. And this lists a bunch of projects. One of them is 2009 road improvement program, and there's only $33,000 there. Is that $33,000 we can put towards our 2015 road project?
Again, for one thing, this is a snapshot in time, like I said, at 12/31/14. So I see your $33,000, and that's the cash balance, but in order to determine if it was spendable, you have to look at the improvement authorizations, which you can find on sheet 9C.
I'll let you find it and tell me.
That's what you say. You can expand it?
It's funded.
Excuse me?
It's funded.
So we could transfer that money. Okay, good. That's good news.
Yep.
I don't have some of these neat stickums, so I have everything earmarked. So
I've dropped them off at your house.
I can loan this online.
I think Vera steals them. You went through that. There was one page I can't find. And I'm going to paraphrase it.
Okay.
And then I'll find it. But it went back to, like, as far as, I'm going to say, 2014 bills. And it listed everything, and it listed legal fees. And in 2014, we reduced our legal fees by about $170,000.
It's on the statement of expenditures, Exhibit A3. So you underspent the budget by $170,000, yes.
So that's true. Damn good news. I know Fred may not think that, but I mean, so we are making headway into, and again, being a city on transitional aid, we're looking to cut costs, we're looking to increase revenue. So overall, I guess that was all my questions, and I appreciate it.
Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Dave, thank you much. Okay. Appreciate it. Moving down to letter D on your work session agenda, review of agenda items for your August 26th regular meeting. Anything in your packet that we need to go over?
I had one thing, Tony, and if you have to look at, and it might take me a minute to find it, there's a grant, and I want to say it's for the Social Services Department.
The Senior Center grant.
Yeah, and there's no amount, and we're matching funds. Can you just get me an amount for it?
$31,320.
Okay. And then when we're doing grants, can we make sure the amount's in the grant, in the resolution when we're voting on it?
What resolution is that?
Oh, I just had it.
That's not what we discussed.
No, we're not discussing it. It's the 24th. So you didn't vote for the special ed committee yet.
The resolution authorizing the submission of the 2015-298.
298. Oh, I had a question saying explain that. Okay, so.
Well, I just didn't know the amount. And what's it for? Can you explain it, Tony?
That's from the Office on Aging. It said $27,320 are directly to the senior center, and there's a $4,000 total that comes along with that.
And then we are matching 25% of those funds?
Yes. Which we easily do at the senior center.
And the other one that didn't have an amount, and Kevin, this is for you, was the 2015-300 for the body armor, but we're not matching, but there wasn't an amount.
That's police.
There's no match in that.
Oh, that's the police department.
Yes.
There's no match, but there's no grant amount in it.
No, but I want to say, and you could look in the audit, it's listed, how much we got last year. I think it's the same, right?
Yeah.
I'm not familiar with the grant. I wasn't made aware that it was that on the agenda, so I can't answer that.
So the only thing I'm asking is that the amount of money be put on it when you're asking me to vote on it. I don't have an opinion one way or the other on the amount of money.
I believe it was roughly $700. I'm going to have to verify that.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it was under 10.
Okay.
2015-297. This is an event that's going to happen maybe in October, and it hasn't gone to special events, but you wanted us to approve it now, so I'm going to ask it to be withdrawn and go to special events. I just don't want to approve something and it comes back, well, guess what, you just approved to give them the park for free for 3 months for $100. So let's get the facts.
The crust and orange. Tomorrow we'll talk about it.
They've submitted a special events application.
But it has not gone before special events, and we have about 6 meetings before this date, so.
Yeah,
right, so we can pull it from this agenda and review it at special events and bring it back.
Someone has a liquor license.
Yeah.
That's why.
Okay.
I know they don't always, Cindy just said they always don't come through together.
Okay.
But they probably should.
Okay, but that's something, okay. Right? That's something new. Okay, that's something we're going to have to figure out. Okay.
You probably submitted it at the same time. If it doesn't came in after
the event,
it won't be on until our next one.
Okay, cool. And there's no. Well, he has like 10 days to get it to Trent, so holding it up for the September 12th meeting isn't going to hurt him with ABC whatsoever. 2015-298, that was the one Amy just asked to explain. You did. 2015-301, I saw some emails saying stay away from that for the time being. Is that going to be scheduled for close exec?
I don't know. But yes, there were emails today about that one.
There were emails of council requesting information. If you'd like to go over that information, we certainly can do that in Wednesday's executive session and add it as an item under contract negotiations because it involves an agreement between the city and the county for dispatch.
Sounds good to me. Let me go back to where I have this one down. Okay, that's a big deal. 2015-310. Oh, this is the jazz festival. How many times are we going to advertise the jazz festival? I mean, when do we stop like and pull the plug? And you want to advertise it one more time? Advertise it one more time.
We got nothing the first time.
We've advertised it 3 times and we got
nothing.
And you know, it's every time we write this up and every time we advertise it. Twice. Okay, this would be the third time. This would be the third time, and there's been people swearing, I'm going to reply, and they don't reply.
Didn't we get the one group that said they would do it for the following year?
Yeah.
Would be this one?
And Since then, we advertised it again, they didn't reply. So I have no problem applying one more time, especially after there was a nice jazz festival this past couple of months or so. So again, some of the city can't afford to do it themselves. 2015-36, I think, Fred, that's 306. They're paying for the request. And then 2015-293, bills and claims from the non-meeting of the 12th. The two that I asked to be held are still being held.
Yes.
Because I haven't gotten an answer. Okay, that's all I have.
I had one quick question about the SPCA one. Is that it's a application for a social permit? Is it like a rabies shot thing, or is it a fundraiser thing?
No, it's a fundraiser and to serve liquor.
Okay.
That's what the social permit is. It's a liquor license, okay. Like a one-day liquor license.
Got it.
Dogs are very drunk.
Any other questions?
On the agenda? No.
Matters to be brought up by the City Council.
I'll do it tonight and on Wednesday. I just want to thank John Vig from the Collective Art Tank and the Lake House and Summertime Surf and Marilyn and Leisha for the, we had kids that went through the week Summertime Surf program. We had a group of kids that went through the art program that down at Langosta that was sponsored by John and the Art Tank. And then I didn't hear how the Lake House program went, but it went this week. So just want to give an update on it. Those are new programs in addition to the traditional program that we do each year. So I want to thank all those groups that participated.
That's it. A couple of things. One, Jesse isn't here tonight because he's recovering from surgery, but he's home, he's doing well, and hopefully he'll be back soon. I wanted to thank a couple of people. First, I wanted to thank Jackie Pappas for the jazz weekend. It was a wonderful weekend, starting Friday night with Afro-Cuban Latin jazz in the train station and ending on Sunday at the Paramount. On Saturday, the street was closed at Embry and people were dancing in the street. So it was a wonderful, wonderful weekend, and I wanted to thank her for that. And then another thanks goes to Leisha Floyd. The council has received a number of letters thanking Leisha and the Recreation Department and the Recreation Committee for a wonderful summer program for their children. That they did an extraordinary job, the counselors were fantastic, and that the events and the activities were just wonderful and outstanding. So I wanted to mention that. And last, the Quality of Life Committee is going to be sponsoring a citywide cleanup and spruce up on the weekends of October 10th and October 17th. And there's going to be more information coming, but we are looking for volunteers. So if you're interested in volunteering, if you're a contractor and you want to donate your services, would you please let us know? Thank you.
I'm just going to do a quick mention. The CDBG grant applications are going to go out for advertisement probably at the end of this week. So anyone who wants to apply, I'll announce it again Wednesday.
A couple quick things. And Barbara Krizek is not here tonight. She'll be here Wednesday. Barbara was a big, big, big help in helping the city auction off all that, I'm going to call it junk, that was first sitting on the west side of the tracks, then in Boston Way. And the auction ended yesterday, and we sold just about 100% of everything, and we're talking close to $30,000, so that will come into the city's coffers, which will be a great help, and it gets rid of junk that we had no use for. So Barbara, and that's part of this entire city. The city's made up of volunteers. As much as we're volunteers and we get paid a small stipend, we cannot do it without the help of all the volunteers. So help like that is deeply appreciated, and help by all of you is deeply appreciated. Couple questions. And again, because the audit report and because the budget's coming out next week and everything, Kevin, you may know this. I'm not even looking for answers tonight. The contract for the ambulance service reimbursements, when is that up?
It's been up for quite some time.
When do we go back out to bid on that?
We have not yet. I want to say it was back probably 2009 or 2010.
Should we?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, and there's a lot of things going on right now. Again, being a city, like, and whenever we meet with anybody from the state, be it, first it was Tom Neff, now it's Richie Cunningham. Tim Cunningham.
That's happening.
That was Freudian slip.
We got our aid.
And our aid was reduced, and everybody knows that. And we are a city getting off transitionoid, so we're looking to increase revenues wherever. And this fall, this early winter, we're going to be going through every. Cindy sent everything out to every department head. If you like. Michelle is doing tonight. She's increasing escrow accounts that haven't been increased in 20 years. We're increasing things. We're not clobbering the taxpayers. We're going after businesses. We're going after people that are making a good buck in the city that can afford a small increase. And again, we're not raping. We're not gouging anybody. We're just coming up to the same standards of surrounding municipalities. A good example was the increase in construction fees, where we were way under everybody else, and we're still cheaper than Long Branch and Neptune with all the construction coming online. It's money that's going to be needed to get us off transitional aid. I think we're making the right move. If you read the coaster, you saw we had a big push, and we're going after people that didn't pay mercantile licenses. And this is, you know, it's a bill. I mean, if I don't pay my tax bill, my name's thrown in the newspaper, and you're getting 18%. So we are going after anybody and everybody, and again, not just because we're nasty, it's because that's how we can stop passing on tax increases to the taxpayers. A question came up, and I was asked this. We have, again, close to like $2.4 million in RCA money, and somebody suggested part of the problem is maybe it's because we have too high of a minimum, where some people need like $5,000 to $10,000 worth of repairs on their home, but our minimum is like 15 to 20, so they don't qualify. So is that something we can address in the future?
We can look at it, certainly.
Okay. And I guess that's all I have. Thank you.
Anyone else have anything? Okay, I have nothing. Matters from city attorney?
I have nothing at this time either.
Can I have a motion to open the meeting to the public?
Move it. Second.
The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements will not be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order and, after appropriate warning, may terminate any future comments from the speaker. I will note you do have 3 minutes. Okay.
Time. Okay. Reverend David J. Perry, Jr., 149 Atkins Avenue. I'm here because my community is asking, what's the timetable for the park? And we also are asking about commercial construction on Springwood Avenue. And we're wondering about dog licensing. We need to have someone check all of the dogs that are walking around, and we don't believe that they have licenses. Many people are walking around without equipment to pick up after the dogs, and we're wondering if someone will take a look at that also. And that's it. Thank you.
Well, hold on, and we'll give you a couple answers.
I'll wait for my answers.
Okay. Okay.
The dog licenses have been brought up, and I've had some discussion with our deputy chief Salerno about using specials, to go out the way they did years ago, to go out and just to get the list, and to begin that process of enforcing. All right. As far as the timetable for the Springwood Avenue Park, the park recently went out to bid on the specs on it. All right, we pulled back. The city pulled back on the specs after we saw a couple of mistakes in it by the construction. Suburban construction. It's been rebid as of the 20th of August. And we expect that we're going to award the bid by September 1st. Award the bid by September 1st and have the council approve it at the September 9th council meeting.
Good, because I don't want to lose that money that the county and others have put into it.
As far as commercial construction on Springwood Avenue, we've had some meetings. The mayor and I, several of the other council members, we have had some discussion with some potential contractors for Springwood Avenue. Nothing really that we've seen had been totally viable at this point. The council has indicated in the past is that they are willing to discuss the issue of construction on Springwood Avenue along the corridor with anybody who feels that they have something to offer to the city.
Okay. I'm finished.
No, you can go on because we took some of your time.
Now, there were some questions from the seniors about their shuffleboard and thing. We tried to put one in the senior citizens center, but that plastic that they put down, it's just not working. We were tripping over it, so that was taken up. But we're hoping that to move on with that park. The other thing was about, again, jobs. And they were wondering in the construction for on Springwood Avenue if there could be maybe a supermarket of some kind. We have some vacant lands there at Springwood and DeWitt, and of course the area across from the park. It used to be, when I was growing up, an Acme store at the corner, the northwest corner, northeast corner of Atkins and Springwood. It was an Acme. And we'd like to see that come back, and that way our seniors and others would not have to pay taxi fares to go out to ShopRite and other places. And we thank you for that. Look into it.
Thank you, Dave.
Hey, Mayor, Council, Joe Pepe, Deal Lake. I have a question about, you guys, you came up with this idea of when people are going to build in the city, they have to escrow the money that it's going to cost us in legal fees. And I think that's a great idea. And tonight, you guys have been talking about finding every single penny of savings we can find. But one of the things that can quickly wipe that out is somebody bringing up a lawsuit against the city because they don't like the recommendation by the planning board or what you guys voted to approve. Is the cost of the city representing itself for their position included in that escrow money? In other words, if somebody wants to make an application for a project, and we say, well, we think the project should be A, they say B, is the legal cost part of something that builder has to pay? Do they have to reimburse the city for our legal fees? That's about it.
Fred, answer that one.
Can I just clarify? You're talking about legal fees associated with litigation. If they were to sue us over something they were felt aggrieved over.
Yeah.
The answer would be no. Unfortunately, under New Jersey law, the only cases where a municipality or a defendant can recover legal fees are only in a very small group of cases where, by statute. we can recover legal fees.
So then I have one other quick question. If somebody's going for a variance, they want a change of zoning, they want us to put something that wasn't traditionally conforming there, and we say, okay, this is the project that we'll approve. If they counter with another one, is that deal off the table? Can we go back then and say, nah, let's just keep it the way it was?
Is there something specific you're talking about, Joe, or?
Yeah, the idea of somebody coming into our town and saying, well, I don't like that the planning board has said that we've got to take this horrific stuff that looks like TGIF Friday off the wall, okay, at Johnny Mac's, and then this guy comes in and says, well, I'm going to sue over this. Well, I got a problem with that.
I think, and Fred, you can stop me, and Joe, I apologize for cutting you off.
Sure.
I think he indicated he's not suing the city, he's suing the planning board. It's a separate entity that has their own budget. How they're going to fund that?
Who funds their budget?
The city does to a certain extent.
So it's our money, the homeowner's money. So this guy wants us to pay because he doesn't like what we approved for him. I say just take it off the board and prove nothing and say it is what it is. Keep it the way the zoning is on Main Street. Now you get nothing. I mean, at some point, you got to smack people down and tell them, you can't come in here and bully us. It's not going to happen.
I don't think we can keep people from legally, if they feel aggrieved, they can sue. I mean, if I feel aggrieved right now, I can sue.
Right, and that's America at its finest. I mean, everybody has their day in court. There's nothing we can do until it proceeds. I think for us to talk about a planning board issue here would be irresponsible. I think your comments may be better off at the next planning board meeting. But thank you.
Evening, Mayor, Council. Just a couple quick questions. Arnold Fallhaber, Oakhurst. I see you got the resolution for the 911 service that you're going to vote on. I noticed that in there, there's no yearly increase or anything, that we're going to pay them $672,000. The contract's for 3 or 4 years. How do we know what it's going to cost us next year or the year after? As you know, when we first went into the 9/11 system, we were paying $89,000 a year, and I think that was 4 years ago or 5 years ago. So it went from $89,000 to $680,000. And, you know, I think we need to have a determination as to the yearly increase in the 911 service. That's number one.
Number two?
And number two is, Mr. Parriott, for you, the bid opening for the park is not until September 1st at 11 o'clock in the council chambers here. So the time frame that you just got is going to be a little bit off, but, you know, just so you know. Thank you.
You done, Arthur?
Yeah, that's it. I'm sorry.
Okay. That's why, as Fred indicated, we're going to go to the closed exec to talk about an issue that you brought up as far as the 911, and not debate it tonight. I believe the first year was $440,000.
No.
Okay, well, you send me an email and I'll send you emails. And Ricky left, but I mean, it was, I think it was 440, and that's why we were so confused why it went up 640 the next year, because the first year, we, besides the 440, from what I read, the city gave him $200,000 worth of equipment and furniture, blah, blah, blah. And even Chief Kinman said, well, what happened to the 440?
Right.
Well, that's because we gave you $200,000 else, and it was 640. So we'll look into the numbers.
Yeah, no, I mean, the numbers are the numbers, Mayor.
I don't believe any year started off at $89,000.
And there were a lot of emails with questions.
I have the copy of the, the thing. It was like, I don't know, something. Anything, yeah, I'll get it to you.
Anything you got, but drop me off before Wednesday, and I'll ask those questions.
But the point is, you know, we got to pay what we got to pay. But, you know, what's going to happen in 2 years if they say, we owe you one, now you owe us $1.2 million?
That's why.
You know, what do we do?
That's why we're asking the questions. Wednesday.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. And Arnold, please, give me, drop me off anything.
I thought I had it with me.
Okay. Next.
Jerry,
nobody wants to get up. We'll bang the
gavel. Jerry doesn't want to go. I'll go. Warner Baumgartner, Fifth Avenue.
First, I want to thank whoever got those clothing donation boxes removed from Langford and Asbury. Terrific job there getting rid of those. They were obstructing the view of turning vehicles. I would recommend, though, that there be a bigger comprehensive policy about those boxes. There are several other boxes around town on city property and possibly even obstructing sidewalks and things like that. So I think you need to have a comprehensive policy about these clothing boxes, that they really shouldn't be on public land. What I heard about the boardwalk lighting has me a bit concerned. The issues that Joe brought up about the fixtures having already been picked out and asking about the color of the lighting, I think you should all take a grave concern over that, because this is something, a major project, $1 million or so, that's going to impact the boardwalk for a very long time. I would recommend that these lamps, if they're the ones that are down there, those two test lamps, those are extremely inappropriate lights for down on the boardwalk. They produce an enormous amount of glare, and glare is the enemy of being able to see at night. Glare typically is reserved for used car lots, you know, where somebody wants to call attention to the brand new cars, you know, when they're all sparkly and everything. Bright white lighting is not the appropriate lighting for a pedestrian-friendly environment. So I really think you should revisit the types of fixtures that are going to be placed down there to make them more user-friendly, more people-friendly, and not destroy people's night vision in the process. There's a lot of lighting going up that's really inappropriate and way too bright for the uses. So I think the entire beachfront, as it develops and the infrastructure is built out, I think the lighting levels really need to be addressed in their entirety. Sixth Avenue came up a couple of meetings ago. That is to acquire the closed part of Sixth Avenue that the Berkeley Carteret is currently in possession of, and I had asked some questions about that and recommended that your redevelopment council look into the agreement that was signed years ago about acquiring Sixth Avenue and reopening it for the public. So I'm just wondering whatever became of that. Was it answered or looked into? That's it.
All right, as far as Berkeley Carteret goes, all right, they have looked into it. All right, they're continuing to look into it. All right, Minimum in Scotland, you know, they are looking at it. Carl Kimmins has been looking into it for us. All right.
Okay.
We actually had a meeting, or he had a meeting, all right, with people from the Berkeley Carteret regarding the issue.
Okay.
The clothing boxes, all right, the police department and code enforcement had the boxes removed at Asbury and Langford.
Right. All right. Good job.
They also had indicated that they were going to be monitoring around the city, all right, other clothing bins.
Oh, great. Could I just make a little list and email it to you?
Absolutely.
Yeah, because I see them driving around. Okay, great. And about the light fixtures on the boardwalk, is there a chance to revisit that?
I will talk to Christine Ballard tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah, and the three things, the person I spoke with today had three concerns. One was the warmth of the lights, the throw of the lights, where it throws the light.
Glare.
And the third thing was, and I think the only good thing that came out of Hurricane Sandy was, I don't know if you remember before, maybe it was Madison Marquette, I don't know who put up the sound on those lights. Remember there were speakers on the boardwalk for a while, and you'd walk down the boardwalk and there'd be music.
There were advertising screens that were
right,
attached to the lamps.
There was music that makes the boardwalk not what a boardwalk is for me. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if these lights have those elements on them.
You don't want speakers on the boardwalk.
I don't want speakers. I don't want a sign. I want a light to be a light.
They have the capabilities for it.
They're optional items.
They were optional.
They're not doing it.
Okay.
Did we go over this and I just missed it? I'm spacing on it? Or was it pulled?
We went over.
We did. It wasn't pulled. It was pulled in my brain.
No.
Yeah, what's the big deal with speakers on lights?
I don't want to put somebody pumping music on the boardwalk.
I think it was a combination. I think it was pulled once we talked about it another time.
Yeah, okay.
Or vice versa.
Okay.
I know we did okay to design.
No, we considered putting like a Wi-Fi thing on the lights to get Wi-Fi down.
Which is good.
Okay.
But the other thing,
you're making me nervous when you're like, I don't want any of this stuff on lights.
No, I just think speakers are what you want on lights.
So the only argument I would make to that, and we don't have to have this discussion here, would be is if there was an emergency, there would be a way to reach everybody on the beach if there were speakers. Right? If they said a shark is coming to Asbury Park. There is an ability to reach everybody on the beach. Anyway, whatever. I'm digressing.
And the only thing I would say, maybe we can talk to Christine, is I don't think we can ever get away from the LED or the CFC, the compact fluorescent, but maybe there's a way with the glass to warm the light that comes out of them so it's not that blue.
There is technology that can provide better lighting for that application, and we should certainly look into it. Thanks.
Thank you. I think what Christine said, and Christine was looking to go forward tonight about it, and she had a meeting, I'm going to say two and a half weeks ago with iStar, when the bids came in over the threshold. This is state money, and it's allotted at 980, whatever. And it came in over, and iStar said since day one, they would make up the difference. When she met with them 2.5 weeks ago, I thought it was going to be a brutal meeting. She told me, John, it was smooth, they're going to pay all the difference. Now, tonight, it looks like they did a 180. If they're not paying the difference, there's no new lights. The city does not have another $100,000 to put into these lights,
right.
And they're going to stay the way they are. I mean, this was a deal proposed by iStar. iStar did all the paperwork. This is a state grant that runs out December 31st. If the money is not spent by December 31st, we lose it. If the money is not taken by us by, I'm going to say, September 9th meeting, it's gone. So this is going to happen between now and the next meeting. So any and all questions, and I have no problem, all the questions, by all means, one of your questions as far as brightness and everything. As far as the one concessionaire complaining about his level and everything, I have no compassion for him. I mean, you know, give me a break. We've got a mile of beachfront, and you're worried about your one little building. And I do have compassion for him, and he brought up a good idea, but he was satisfied that...
I thought so, but I will text after this meeting and find out.
I was told by both iStar and Madison Marquette that they talked to him, and he was on board with it. But that's going back 2 months ago.
Right.
So I've never gotten the message. Things changed. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Rita.
Hi. Rita Miranda, 8th Avenue. First, I want to thank Mr. Nuccio because he... gave me my OPA request, but it was incomplete, and I was wondering if he can look at it again and give me all the waivers. I only got two waivers. There was only two. There's a lot more than that, right? The other thing, I didn't hear in the audit about our bonded indebtedness. Does anybody know what that amount is? And the third thing is about Johnny Mack. I mean, it's ridiculous. The place looks horrible. It's across the street from here. There's a time limit on all those things that he has out there. He has trucks on the street. He has a dumpster on the street. Well, why isn't anybody paying attention? He should put a curtain up so nobody could see what he's doing there. It's awful. Everybody that passes here says the same thing. And they go, what's going on there? So, I mean, you have to clamp down on these people. And I don't think I know the planning board is autonomous, whatever you call it, but you elect all those people. And if you don't like what they're doing, you can get rid of them. And there's a couple of things I'd like.
Not until their term is up.
Huh?
Not until their term is up. We just can't say, we don't like your decision, you're out, and put somebody else up. I mean,
if they're not doing a good job,
what?
Like that building on Lake Avenue, you think that's a good job?
But okay, go ahead, Rita.
All right.
But we cannot throw people off of boards because we disagree with them. And I'm not saying I disagree with them because I don't know all the facts. But no, your premise that you're right. We don't elect them, we appoint them. And we cannot unappoint them because we disagree with them or agree with them.
I mean, no, it's not that you disagree.
They have a term. When their term's up, they'll be evaluated.
But you look at the results, and that's a terrible result right there on Lake Avenue. It's on a sidewalk. I mean, like, that's wrong. They can't even put a gas line in there. There's no room. There's no room for a gas line. Well, they're going to be totally electric now? I mean, they have to think these things out. But they don't. But anyway, I'd like to know about the waivers. I didn't go back and look at my request.
You're talking about
And, yeah, because comp time is very important to me. And also, the bonded indemnity. I didn't hear that.
Good question. We'll get you that answer Wednesday.
You don't know it now?
No. By the time I pull out 200 pages and find it, we'll be here for another hour. So we'll get you that answer tomorrow.
All right. Thank you. No, Wednesday's good.
No. You'll get that tomorrow.
Rita, which open request are you talking about?
The one I asked, remember the night you said, I asked you about and you said that you got waivers for everything, though Don Sabbath was one of them.
There's two waivers for comp time. All right. Waivers were not submitted for comp time prior to Tim Cunningham becoming the Director of Local Government Finances. All right. Prior to that, under Tom Neff, all right, if someone left, and my recollection is the only people who left during that time had been several police officers. All right. So the two waivers that you got were for Joe Cunha and they were for Don Salmon. Those were the only two waivers because when they were leaving, it became an issue with local government services.
But also in the union contracts, you got new ones now. They're open end. They don't say you have to use your comp time by 30 days or 90 days.
The only contract that's open-ended is the Ask Me contract.
What?
The only contract that is open-ended that way is the Ask Me contract.
Well, why is
which
that?
Is the professional contract. All right, but according to our personnel policy, all right, individuals are not going to be able to accumulate the amounts they have in the past. Mm-hmm. All right, we've asked the department heads to curtail and to reduce their comp times.
Could you eliminate it?
Not now, we couldn't. All right, if you eliminate that, according to, and I'm going to go back to the Fair Labor Standards Act, if you eliminate that comp time, then you're going to be paying for time and a half for overtime.
Yeah, but when somebody has 800 hours, you know what that represents?
I'm sure that when you go back to employees, you know, when they have 800 hours, I'm sure that many of them would say to you, I would have appreciated having the time and a half, rather than having the comp time.
Okay, but Tony, do me a favor. Call either Ricky or Dave Kaplan tomorrow and get Rita the number she's looking for. Rita, what exactly are you looking for? Total debtness by the city?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm guessing 40 million. I don't know, but I'm not going to think. We'll get you the right number tomorrow.
Okay. But he said something about a tax levy tonight, 25 million or something.
Who did?
The auditor.
Dave.
29. What is the tax levy?
Oh, yeah, that's probably correct. Yeah, the tax levy was $25
million.
$25 million, yeah. What we need to raise by taxes to make the city work. And that doesn't include county taxes or Board of Education taxes.
Hello, Mayor and Council. Jerry Scranton, Long Branch. My questions are, the old inspection station on 3rd Avenue, I was wondering why that still is the way it is, why we can't ask the state to take it away and sell off that land to be developed for housing or whatever. And the other thing was, you know, I think it's the state building, the blue building on 4th and Memorial. It was supposed to be a Board of Education building or something like that. That's sitting empty. I don't know why we can't find somebody to use it for a school or something, for job training or insurance company to have an outlet there or something that gives training to new people, new computer skills, whatever, but do something with that site instead of having an empty building. The other thing is, we sold off our surplus. I just want to know one item. How much did we get for the old parking meters that got ruined? I want to know how much we got paid for them. But I think we owe a lot of money on them.
Yeah.
And if we did lose a lot of money, I think we should send the old city manager the bill because he was the hero with that deal. And then the other thing, on Facebook, everybody's cheering iStar with the new hotel, the C8 site, Esperanza site.
Shouldn't we have a model of that building? I'd like to see a model of it. I'd like to know about what's going to really happen, how the parking's going to go in and out of the building. Everybody should know instead of just saying, oh, it's a beautiful picture. That was as dumb as when Sue Henderson said the Salvation Army building looked good because it had night lights on. But I'd like to know about the parking. I'd like to see a model. And if it's going to be a building of the future, are they going to have solar panels on it? What are they going to do it to make it a building of the future? Right now, it looks like an old Le Corbusier building like they have in Newark, all glass. I thought they were supposed to have a couple of architects or different designs on one block, the way they did with the Barcelona, Seville, and the Monterey. It shouldn't just be one glass building, according to the picture that I saw. So if you could help me out with a model so I could see what's going on there, why it's going to be just a glass building. We need a model. And that's it. If you can give me the answer to four things or whatever.
Well, done? You sure?
See, you like that picture.
You done, Jerry?
Yes.
Now, I'm going to bang around. 1100 block of 3rd, good question. We can write a letter to the state, ask them what the long term is for that. Because it used to be you could drive your cars through there and get inspected. Now it's just for special vehicles.
Right now it's just a parking lot for trucks.
It's commercial vehicles, right? Yeah. 4th and Memorial. Thank you. I totally forgot about that. You're absolutely right. The city's remiss. We have to send the state of New Jersey. That building sitting there empty. It's owned by the state of New Jersey.
Make it an office building. Make it something
nobody
useful.
Nobody will touch it because it has an assessed value of $5 million. And for the state should just give it to the city. And maybe we can knock it down and build the new firehouse there or something like that. Maybe we could do something with it and then sell the firehouse land as a rateable. Get something back on the books. But that's a must. We that letter has to go out. So I'm glad you remind me on that. As far as you saying everybody being in favor of iStar, I've gone to Nextdoor and Facebook, I'd say it's 50-50. I mean,
what?
Tops. I'd say, as far as everybody being in favor of iStar, I'd say it's tops 50-50. There's 50% saying good, 50% saying it stinks. So I don't think it's 100% saying it's good. But again, as far as models, future meetings, they went before the TRC. You had every right to be there and ask questions then. They're going to come before the council.
I didn't know about that meeting.
Okay, they're going to come before the council. You have every right to come and ask those questions then. And then it's the final is planning board. And these are all good questions that I'm sure you'll attend and ask those questions. I think I hit everything. But
well, just the building of the future with the solar panel. I mean,
okay, but that's a good question to ask them. But you know, when they're making their presentation to us, if you don't ask it, I'll ask it when they make the presentation.
Okay.
On
oh, and then will we ever get a number on what those old meters sold for?
I think, and I'm going to, off the top of my head, they went for scrap value $1,250.
And we owe $50,000 on them, don't we, or something?
I do not know.
Well, I'll ask Rita. She'll tell
me. We owe $50,000 on...
They were
450. 100 and some meters, not just these 50. Because they bought originally 50 and then another 60. So I think the total you're talking about is for like 110.
So I would like to know the difference between our loss and $1,200. That's a lot of money.
It is a lot of money, but they were left to be hit by Sandy. They were not taken up. Red Bank took up all theirs and lost none of them. It's 4 bolts. They could have been unscrewed. They could have been put in a warehouse. They weren't. That's hindsight. That's order over the dam. We have to go forward. They were taking up 2 garage bays. My trucks were outside rotten. We put them on an auction. There was no bids for it because they're scrap metal. Scrap metal, if everybody knows, is looking at the stock market. Stock market's getting clobbered. China's getting clobbered. A month ago, we were getting paid for recyclables. Right now, we're paying for recyclables. Because why? China's economy is tanking also. So as much as like in this order...
Well, I don't want to blame China for our mismanagement skills here.
But as far as like scrap metal, every day the prices are dropping.
I understand.
I mean, a truck 2 months ago, my buddy's in the business I work for. 2 months ago, you could take any car and get $400 for it at a junkyard. Right now, you're getting $225. And it all has to do with the world. It's not just you know, America. So I think we answered all your questions, and good questions about 1100 Ocean Avenue, and we'll see you at the planning board and see you at the council meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry. Yes, Mr. Spratley.
William Spratley, Fifth Avenue. 2 years ago, the man was planting trees on Fifth Avenue. And so I asked him not to plant a tree in front of my house because I have a tree in my front yard. So they told me, says, well, they got to plant them there. So I said, why? So he tells me these big trees are coming down. This is what the state told me. The guy from the state told me these big trees they're going to take down. And that's why they were planting smaller trees. This was 2 years ago now. He said within the near future, like a year or so. Now, I noticed about 6 weeks ago, I'm looking at the news, and I see them down in Rumson marking trees. They claim they're taking these trees down in Rumson, but nobody knows anything about the trees in Asbury Park. What's going on with those trees? Does anybody know anything?
I don't at this time, but we'll have Tony look into it and get back to you.
Tomorrow. Definitely look into it. It's the first time hearing about this.
Because I have a driveway in front of my house. It's a concrete driveway. And the trees, and the wire goes across the street, and the branches on the trees are hanging on the wire. So I called about that. The electric company sent somebody over there. They told me they were going to trim the trees in a couple of years or a year and a half. Nobody showed yet.
What's your address on Fifth Avenue?
1003.
I'll have somebody look at it tomorrow.
Okay. Who?
Verizon was cutting branches down for the trees on Sixth Avenue.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Excuse me.
Thank you, Mr. Spratt.
Thank you.
Good evening. Ellen Muller, 1501 Ocean Avenue. Earlier this summer, we've made some requests for additional trash cans on Ocean Avenue. From 6th to the food truck park, there aren't any, and there's none on 7th. So on the weekend mornings, I go out with a big trash bag when I walk my dog, and I pick up trash. And one of the things I noticed that on the west side of Ocean Avenue, in front of our building, there's two trash cans, and I never have to pick up trash there. So surprisingly, people actually use them if they're there. But there's not a single trash can. There's one on the corner of 6th and Ocean. There's none. You actually have to go into the food truck park, and there's none on 7th. Now, there is a blue one on 7th. No one seems to use that. I think people think that's recycling. But so generally speaking, we're just asking. We've asked a couple of times and asking again. And now I'm going to drag this dead horse to water and see if I can get it to swim. It's August 2015. August 2012, I was here and asked when the landscaping that was removed from the medians on 6th and 7th Avenue to allow for the Bamboozle Festival was going to be replaced as promised. And I've been here, as you all know, intermittently through the years, asking again. This past spring, Pat and I actually went out and secured 3 bids for the landscaping to help DPW and to help the council. Our growing season, our planting season's coming to an end, and we'd still like to know where our landscaping is. Landscaping that we were promised that with the funds that the city received for the rental of that property would be used to replace all the landscaping that was torn out. Thank you.
Thank you. Tony, you'll look into that. Okay. Motion to close.
Move it.
Second.
Any other issues? Motion to adjourn?
Move it.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? All right.